So hello everyone, thank you for coming, thanks to Yulia for putting this together, and the library for letting us be here. My name is Sergio Coyote. They call me that because I'm a coyote. What I'm here to talk about today is the maps that are in the show. These are over there in the library. That's Mexico, Europe, and America at the end. And that's the British Isles. And I talk about the maps and what they are, which are, they're myths. Like when the ancient Greeks or whoever would look up to the night sky and see stars and see forms and figures in the stars and make characters out of them, and they would interact with each other based on their relationship physically to each other. And so what I do with the maps is sort of the same thing, kind of in reverse. If you were looking down at the land and seeing the forms and shapes in the mountains and rivers and cities and stuff. And likewise, my process basically with the maps is to do the same, to make characters out of them and see how they interact. In ancient times, I guess this was the sort of basis for cultural life. Today, it's a condition known as pareidolia, seeing faces in clouds and wood grain and stuff like that. I guess on one hand, it's sort of a natural inclination for all humans to sort of do, but on the other hand, if you take it too seriously, you're considered a little funny in the head. But I do take them a little bit seriously. I think the faces are basically really there because everything, I would say, is alive. And so everything has a face. That's why I've been a facist my entire life. So about 12 years ago or so, I acquired a big stack of used National Geographic maps from an old bookstore and decided to start painting on them. I would see faces and such in the features and started to pull those into focus. And the countries and continents became little characters that interact with each other. And the nice thing was that whoever sort of looked at them could make up their own story, their own myth about what's going on between these people. That's New York City, Long Island, down at the end. And so they became pretty open-ended for people, and you could kind of do whatever you want. The one problem was that the faces were not always in the right places. The map is based on, you know, the actual place that's being pictured, and so it's not necessarily done with any regard to the composition, or especially the composition once you put a face on Spain. So it took a lot of work sometimes to, you know, just like the face, to draw out of the other features, the borders, the coastlines, to kind of get a usable composition out of it that wouldn't, you know, sort of fall apart. And as I was doing this, I kind of realized that the map and what was sort of, what came with the map was kind of telling the story. That's the Atlantic Ocean upside down. And the more paint I would add, the paint started adding to the story as well. And eventually, I had very little to do with it. And the maps were sort of a side project that was going on at the time. And they largely became exercises in making a composition out of something that had a bad composition to start with. At the time, my main focus was a sort of large scale, oh, here's some maps that aren't on maps, they're just paintings of places. That's New Zealand. Asia, Antarctica, Europe. This is the Philippines versus the Borneos. Japan. But what I was normally doing was large-scale sort of history paintings, very intricately composed, very controlled, and they contained a lot of information that I, you know, decided ahead of time that I wanted to put in. This is actually sort of based on Guernica. It's called Gadnita, like meat. It's about mad cows and medicine. And I was doing these for a long time. The maps were sort of around 2000, 2001. I continued actually to do paintings like this until around 2006 or so. Actually, right about the time the war was really getting going in Iraq, did a lot of war paintings. This is the zombie John Hancock signing the Declaration of Independence. At first these works, they took a lot of work, it took a long time. They rarely sort of came out the way I had originally intended. This is the Battle of the Living Dead when we were fighting the Fallujans. This is from here to Houston. A giant midget snake handler trying to save a baby that wants to be sacrificed to the devil. Eventually, they became easier and easier to do. I could do one of these in a few days. They came out looking pretty much like what I had hoped for. This is the last thing you'll ever see. Zombie attack. No one will hear your screams. I should point out that, sort of in film criticism, you find a lot of times people using horror movies and finding social commentary in them, and that's sort of the same thing I kind of use to make my social commentary. Say stealth jet flying over the pyramids. But like I said, eventually they became pretty easy to do. I wanted to do something different. I started pouring, I wanted to make a really dark, ugly, muddy painting and see what it would look like, and I was pouring black and red and ink and water onto the paper, and this should have a little more detail, but and seeing what it would come out like. And right away it reminded me of the same thing that was going on with the maps, these very organic shapes that sort of worked their way around and became something on their own. Even more so than with the maps, the paint was really doing all the talking, all the work. A lot of times all I had to do was put a couple of eyeballs. And so I started getting into what that was all about. It was almost like the ones that I did the least work to came out the best. And something else was going on. What happened, I think, was that, the paint was making the picture. It was, sort of literally moving into place on its own accord with its own consciousness to create the image that it wanted, to tell the story that it wanted to tell. Found that sometimes I could control this. Once in a while, if I was thinking about something when I poured the paint, that thing would kind of come up. Other times, I wouldn't really think about anything and just sort of let it go. And it became a combination of the paint interpreting, I guess, my own subconscious, which is why so many of these paintings are monsters and dead people. And, but also I think the consciousness of the cosmos was working through the paint as well. That's the sort of best understanding I have of what was going on. Sort of a combination of my mind and the universe working together to make the paint. And then, you know, the paint was involved also. I think everyone involved had something they wanted to say. And it sort of become my job to just let that happen, kind of translate, and then once it's ready, to sort of draw out into focus what the image was supposed to be, what the painting wanted to be. And they could be landscapes or figures. And they can get pretty fine. This was done with the same sort of process. These, not quite so drippy. I'm having trouble moving the slide here. They're sort of like man-made Polaroids, where, you know, you take the picture and slowly all the chemicals ooze together, and eventually the image comes out. So I think of it as sort of a style of kung fu, painting kung fu, telepathic mind control painting, I call it. Vomit style, refers to how the paint is applied to the canvas. It's sort of a cosmic vomiting of living, conscious paint, liquid color, light, being sort of spewed forth into existence. Something that did not exist before. It's not changing. Sorry. It's stuck. For the most part, though, I have, I'm there when it happens, but I have very little to do with it. I'm kind of done talking. Well, anyway, I'm having a little trouble getting more slides up, but that is the end of my talk, so it's not that big of a problem. I'm sorry it was so short, but hopefully you got the idea.
Great to see you.
Thank you.